मेडिकल थेरापी, रेडियोटाइडीन एंड सर्जरी। हर एक का अपना अपना एक इंडिकेशन है एंड देयर डिफरेंट पेशेंट्स दे हैव डिफरेंट इंडिकेशंस फॉर। लाइक टू स्टार्ट विद एवरी पेशेंट हैज टू बी प्ले पुट ऑन एंटी थायराइड ड्रग्स एंड दिस ट्रीटमेंट शुड बी मिनिमम इट शुड बी गिवन फॉर 2 years, right? Only then you can discontinue this treatment. So those patients who have a larger thyroid, physically enlarged thyroid, number one, are evidence of tracheal compression or compression symptoms, and those who are having some evidence of malignant transformation, they are the candidates for surgical intervention. On the other side, those patients who are on discontinuation of the treatment, they don't sustain on the treatment and they need prolonged medical therapy. And if their age is more than 45, they have completed their family and there's no other contraindication for the radioactive iodine. So ideally they have to be placed on, they have to be subjected to radioactive iodine therapy. Anybody who wants to add to this, this is a general principle of these different, three different modalities of the thyrotoxicosis. Anybody who has got different opinion regarding the treatment? Hello?
Sir, सर अकॉर्डिंग टू एज ट्रीटमेंट उन्होंने दी हुई थी सर जी के 25 इयर्स और मोर देन 25 इयर्स का किसमें नियर टोटल करनी है किसमें टोटल थायरॉइडेक्टमी करनी है सिर्फ सर्जरी की पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से सर वो जरा अगर क्लियर कर दें सर जी हमें
नहीं उसकी तरफ तो आते हैं हम देखिए अच्छा, मैंने कहा रेडियोएक्टिव आयोडीन की इंडिकेशन तब बनती है जब ट्रीटमेंट को ट्रीटमेंट के साथ रिकरेंस हो पेशेंट को फिजिकली थायराइड इनला ज्यादा इनलार्ज नहीं है कंप्रेशन सिम्टम्स नहीं है मेलिग्नेंसी के चांसेस नहीं है सो एंड एज उसकी एडवांस है फैमिली साइज उसने कंप्लीट किया हुआ है सो सच पेशेंट्स आर कैंडिडेट्स फॉर रेडियोएक्टिव आयोडीन रेडियोएक्टिव आयोडीन में हम डिस्कस करेंगे डिटेल में उसके क्या हैजर्ड्स हैं ऑन द अदर हैंड पेशेंट्स हु आर हैविंग फिजिकली इनलार्ज थायराइड विद कंप्रेशन सिम्टम्स एंड एविडेंसेस ऑफ मेलिग्नेंसीज आर चांसेस ऑफ मेलिग्नेंसी तो वो तो they are candidates for surgical intervention. And totally patients having Graves disease, thyroid enlarged nahi hai, and baki usme koi jo hai na wo contraindication nahi. So these are the patients who are candidates for only medical therapy. Samajh aaye?
Theek hai.
So these are three different categories of patients. So now discussing the medical management one by one. जी बताएं
सर द मेडिकल मैनेजमेंट द मेडिकल मैनेजमेंट वन इज फॉर द हाइपरथायरॉइड सिम्टम्स एंड द अदर इज फॉर द एड्रेनर्जिक सिम्टम्स दैट इज द बीटा ब्लॉकर्स कैन बी यूज्ड फॉर दैट एंड द थायरॉइड मेडिकेशंस दे आर डिफरेंट क्लासेस वन व्हिच इनहिबिट द थायरॉइड सिंथेसिस आर द थायनामाइड्स व्हिच इंक्लूड्स प्रोपाइल थायोरेसिल मेथिमेजोल एंड कार्बिमेजोल एंड व्हिच इनहिबिट द आयोडाइड ट्रैपिंग आर द थायोसाइनेट्स एंड परक्लोरेट्स एंड द हार्मोन रिलीज इनहिबिटर्स दे इंक्लूड ड्यूगॉल्स आयोडीन एंड द अदर आयोडाइड सॉल्यूशंस एंड थायरॉइड टिश्यू डिस्ट्रक्शन एजेंट्स देन वी कैन मूव ऑन टू द radioactive iodine ablation and other than that we can also use dexamethasone for the ophthalmopathy and ethinolol also for the beta blocking effect calcium yes. channel blocker diltiazem has little role
ठीक है so basically thionamides they are the basic units of the treatment for the primary release of to inhibit the primary release of thyroid hormones and then the secondary effects they can be blocked by beta blockers and other drugs Lugol's iodine on one side is mostly used for patients who are to be prepared for surgical intervention because it decreases the blood supply it changes the consistency of the thyroid gland and it to some extent it inhibits the release of hormone from the gland to the general circulation, but for a shorter period of time. And radioactive iodine is, on the other hand, is a modality of treatment. But it's in radioactive iodine therapy, you need to follow the patient for a long time, because most of these patients, they will render the patient is totally hypothyroid. The patient has to be placed on hormone replacement therapy for the rest of his life. Number two, there can be other complications associated with the initial phase of the treatment, and that has to be looked for. So it has got its own indications and contraindications. So what are the good candidates for radioactive iodine therapy and how it is initiated? First of all, tell me, what is the ideal treatment for the medical treatment for thyroid toxicosis and medical treatment for preparation of the patient for thyroid surgery? These are two different treatment modalities. So suppose we are treating the patient with medical management. So how do you treat that?
Can I proceed? So first we need, before making the patient a candidate for surgery, we give the patient at antithyroid medication at least for 12 to 18 months. And if the patient after 2 years does not still respond to antithyroid medication, then we consider him as a candidate for surgery or radioactive iodine.
So how do you start with?
We usually start with.
Suppose you are starting the patient on thionamides, or carbamazole, methimazole, and PTU.
The carbamazole is that neomarcazole. We usually start with that in a young lady like this. She is pregnant or lactating, then PTU is a better option. So the dosage is around 40 to 60 mg per day for 3 weeks around, and then we give 20 to 40 mg for another two months. And then we continue the dose for up to 2 years until we resolve the thyroid surgery.
Yes. You give a minimum of treatment for 2 years and discontinue and look for the symptoms and clinical and biochemical changes. If the disease recurs, so he or she should be considered for the second line therapy. If the patient remains disease free and there is no physical enlargement of thyroid, cosmetically speaking, and local symptoms are not there, so you have to leave it alone. But the second category of the patients who have either intolerance to the antithyroid drugs, number one, or there is some contraindication for the patient is having recurrent symptoms and biochemistry after discontinuation of the treatment, or the patient has got physically enlarged thyroid with local symptoms, compression symptoms, and chances of malignancy, so that patient has to be considered for surgical intervention. Radioactive iodine therapy, how do you give it?
Sir, first we have to make the patient start on antithyroid medications, and once he or she is euthyroid, then we stop the antithyroid medications for 2 weeks before we give the radioactive iodine ablation, and it can be given as a single shot. After that, after 6 to 8 weeks, we then repeat the TFTs. And if they're still not normalized, we give another radioactive iodine ablation shot, and we can go maximum. Yes.
First, the patient has to be discontinued on antithyroid drugs 5 days before the administration of dose. Then soon after the dose is administered, 1 week after that, the patient has to be started on the antithyroid drugs once again. And it has to be continued for 6 to 8 weeks. And after 3 months' time, it has to be the patient is not symptom free, so you can repeat the dose. So the patient can have 2 or 3 more doses. Okay, and contraindications and complications, as we already know. So what are the contraindications and complications?
Contraindications to radioactive iodine ablation can be children less than 5 years of age, and pregnant and lactating ladies, And if there is no facility available for radioactive iodine ablation
therapy,
and if the patient cannot come for a follow-up because this leads
The patient has to be followed for a long time. Yes, this is another indications. What else? Yes, any hypersensitivity or intolerability to the, yes, good point raised by Waleed.
Patients to surgery. The patient is not a surgical candidate.
Yes. So now coming to the surgical intervention, and what are the good candidates for surgical intervention?
So those who are non-compliant to medications, who mm-hmm. cannot tolerate antithyroid drugs.
Yes, hypersensitivity or intolerant. Mm-hmm.
If there is moderate to severe ophthalmopathy, and goiter is so large that it's causing obstructive symptoms, there's difficulty in breathing and swallowing, and the patient refuses to take medication or have a thyroid ablation therapy, or if the patient is pregnant, we can opt for surgery.
So how do you prepare a patient? How do you prepare a patient for surgical intervention?
The same way, first we make the patient euthyroid with medications, and once the patient is euthyroid, then mm-hmm. we proceed ahead with the surgical intervention.
Okay, so you're making euthyroid first, repeat the thyroid function test, make sure the patient is have hypertension, diabetes, and other comorbid conditions like cardiac conditions are well treated and well controlled. And then you do a preoperative indirect laryngoscopy and get a CT, get a X-ray neck AP and lateral view done for detection and deviation of the trachea, if there is any, and get a chest X-ray done again for the same reason, for retrosternal extension of the thyroid, and then the patient has to be prepared for surgery. So as you all know, there are different types of surgical interventions.
Hello?
I think we've lost sir. We'll just wait for some time till his internet is working again. Hello? Yes, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, there is a question from Dr. Shafkat.
Yes.
So he says that thyrotoxicosis causes gynecomastia. How carbamazole relieves the symptoms of gynecomastia?
Okay, I don't think gynecomastia is a big problem in thyrotoxicosis. It can be mild to moderate gynecomastia. But antithyroid drug does not relieve that complication. Hello?
Yes, sir. So you were asking the question about surgical options, I think.
Yes.
We can opt for a near total or a total thyroidectomy.
So what's the ideal treatment for such a patient, which you mentioned about, if the surgical intervention is we opt for. So what is the ideal treatment?
Near total thyroidectomy.
What's near total thyroidectomy?
When you leave 1-sided hemithyroidectomy and contralateral, we leave 2 grams of thyroid tissue.
So, right, near total thyroidectomy. So there are a lot of debate on that, but if you choose a single answer, so near total thyroidectomy, you remove the whole lobe on one side, you remove the isthmus, and you leave behind only 2 grams of the thyroid tissue on the other side. So this is near total thyroidectomy. So one is subtotal thyroidectomy.
In subtotal, we leave the thyroid tissue in both the glands. Some says 2 grams of thyroid tissue, some says 4 grams. So there's a controversy.
2 grams on either side. So this is subtotal thyroidectomy. What is Delbridge? Hello?
Sorry, sir.
Okay. And one is lobectomy. Lobectomy means you remove one lobe of thyroid. One is hemithyroidectomy, when you remove you do lobectomy along esophagectomy, that is known as hemithyroidectomy. And total thyroidectomy is total thyroidectomy, that everybody knows about that, right? And Dunhill is when you do total lobectomy on one side, when you do esophagectomy on the other side, but you leave behind 4 grams of thyroid tissue on one side, that is Dunhill technique, right? So if you leave behind 4 grams, 2 grams on either side, that becomes a subtotal thyroidectomy. And when you leave behind 4 grams on only one side, that is known as Dunhill technique. And then you leave behind only 2 grams on one side and the remaining tissue is removed, that is near total thyroidectomy. So there are a lot of debate on that. Everybody has got his own choice. But total thyroidectomy is only confined and is only reserved for patients who are suspected to have differentiated carcinoma of thyroid and sometimes bilateral MNG makes an indication for total thyroidectomy. Otherwise, majority of the cases you go for near total thyroidectomy, right? And if the disease is confined to one lobe, then you do for lobectomy or hemithyroidectomy. So, can you tell me about the different precautions while doing thyroidectomy and operative steps? Hello? Hello? Yes, go ahead.
Sir, can I proceed?
Yes,
sir,
yes.
In the surgery, since thyroid surgery, the position is basically the rose position, or sandbags are placed under the shoulder and the neck is hyperextended. Then the incision is a collar incision, transverse collar incision. It usually extends between the two sternomastoid and a little above the two or 3 centimeter above the sternal notch. And then incising the skin, subcutaneous tissue and the platysma muscle, the flaps are raised, and then we encounter the anterior jugular vein if present, that is ligated. And investing layer is then opened, that is also opened vertically. The strap muscles can be pulled apart or they can be cut if more so in the upper part because of the ancestors have Achilles centers in the lower part. So
strap muscles are either retracted laterally or they can be divided.
They can be divided from above. Then there comes the pretracheal fascia, and yes, that is also incised. And then the thyroid is visualized. The thyroid gland. First of all, we look for the middle thyroid vein. That is the first vessel that we ligate. And after that, we look for the other vessels, that is the superior thyroid arteries. They are ligated near to the pole. The separate branches are ligated, and then the thyroid is pushed and the parathyroid gland.
The superior pole vessels. That is. Sorry to interrupt you.
Yes, sir.
Maria?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
The superior pole vessels, they are ligated after they are individually identified. And yes, after the superior external branch of superior laryngeal nerve is identified, it is safeguarded, number one. Mass ligation of the superior pole vessels are to be discouraged. Then you retract the lobe medially and look for the and identify the Riedel's triangle. And what are the boundaries of the Riedel's triangle?
So the Riedel's triangle, it is bounded laterally by the carotid, and medially we have the tracheoesophageal groove, and above we have ITA, inferior thyroid artery, and the recurrent laryngeal nerve is also said to form its medial boundary.
Yes, the recurrent laryngeal nerve and the inferior parathyroid glands are the contents of this. So you have to preserve the gland and you have to push it downwards. Try to avoid ligating the main branch of the inferior thyroid artery, because it's an end artery and it's the only blood supply to inferior parathyroid glands. So you try to identify and the individual branches and ligate the individual branches of the inferior thyroid artery. Identify the nerve. It can either pass through the branches of the ITA, or it can pass in front of it or behind it. Whatever the course of the nerve is, you have to make sure that it is identified, it is preserved, and it is followed till it enters into the larynx. And at times, it divides different branches, and you have to take care of the different branches of the inferior laryngeal nerve. Sometimes ligation and mass ligation of the inferior vessel at the inferior pole of the thyroid, that can lead to injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. That has to be avoided. And ultimately, while detaching the lobe from the trachea by incising the Barry's ligaments, again, that's the point where you can injure the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So these different points have to be taken care of, and you have to make sure that the nerve is not injured.
So that is the triangle of concern.
Yes. So what are the main complications associated with thyroidectomies? Hello?
So they can be per-op complications, immediate post-op. And,
hello?
Yes, sir. Hello?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, sir. So they can be immediate complications per-op. They could be bleeding, injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve, a damage to the vital structures like really trachea, carotids, or veins. Then post-operatively, the biggest complication, a hematoma can form, and it can cause compression symptoms.
Okay, importantly, there can be anatomical complications, and there can be metabolic complications. Metabolic complication can be in the form of hypoparathyroidism and hypocalcemia and hypothyroidism. So these are the metabolic complications associated with thyroidectomy. And there could be anatomical complications, as you rightly mentioned, nerve to the superior laryngeal nerve, injury to the superior laryngeal nerve, injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve, and injury to other structures, leading to hematoma formation, bleeding, infections, skin flap necrosis, and fistula formations, and all these complications can happen. But the two most important complications which are to be looked after and which are to be avoided are the nerve injuries and the hyperparathyroid gland injuries, and right. So how to avoid injury to the parathyroid gland? Hello? Made to avoid injury to the parathyroid glands on either side. So you have to identify the parathyroid gland, number one. You should keep the plane of dissection superficial to the parathyroid gland. Number two, try not to evulse it from its base. Number three, you should not ligate the main branch of the main trunk of the inferior thyroid artery. Because I earlier said it's an artery and it can be the only blood supply to the parathyroid glands, number one. And number three, if it is inadvertently removed, so try to reimplant it into the sternocleidomastoid muscle after dividing into smaller pieces and making smaller pieces of it and reimplant it. And if it happens, then the patient, how the patient will present post-operatively?
damage to the parathyroid.
Post-operative hypocalcemia.
Yes.
Tetany.
Yes. The patient can present with the carpopedal spasm, circumareolar numbness and tangling and paresthesia. There can be confusion, convulsions, coma, or there can be stridor edema and difficulty in breathing and acropathy, and these are all complications associated with the hypoparathyroidism. It can be treated by either giving IV calcium gluconate 10-20 ml of it diluted and transfused slowly over a period of 10 to 15 minutes. And in long-term replacement, the patient has to be started on the calcium preparation, not only calcium, magnesium, and the vitamin D should also be added to it. Right. And what are the complications associated with nerve injuries?
Sir, I've got a question.
Yes?
Like how many patients you have seen who has presented with hypoparathyroidism post-thyroidectomy? How many patients you have seen and how many of you have managed?
Okay, it's not that uncommon complication, right? So the hypoparathyroidism can be either permanent or it can be temporary, or there can be hypoparathyroidism, which is fictitious type of hypoparathyroidism. So normally speaking, once you deal and you handle the parathyroid gland and you can temporarily disturb the blood supply to it, so there can be temporary dysfunction of the parathyroid in the patient. Once put on the replacement therapy, can do better after some time. But it's very rare to have a permanent hypoparathyroidism. Right, so that can happen, and in that case, the patient has to be followed for a long time. Right, what else?
So I think we need to wind up because the meeting will end soon, and
so we have.
Okay.
I think if anyone has any other questions, so we can just discuss that and end this session.
We have the last 5 minutes for this session today.
Last
5 minutes. Half minutes now.
I can't hear you properly.
It's last
5 minutes.
Okay, last 5 minutes. So just a few points about the recurrent laryngeal nerve injury. So recurrent laryngeal nerve injury has to be avoided, and if it happens, what happens, it can be unilateral, there can be bilateral. There can be unilateral partial, there can be bilateral partial. So all have their own implications, but long-term and at the end of the day, the patient can have hoarseness of voice, loss of voice, a difficulty in breathing, ineffective cough, and constant cleansing of the throat, these complications. If there is injury to the superior laryngeal nerve, it can lead to low pitch sound, ineffective coughing, and repeated aspiration, because it is the nerve which is responsible for supply to this cricothyroid muscle, which is the tensor of the vocal cord. And recurrent laryngeal nerve, as you all know, it's the nerve supply to all intrinsic muscles of the larynx. So this is all about the complications of the recurrent laryngeal nerve associated with. And there is one point that sometimes if the patient is not properly prepared and the patient is not prepared properly for the surgical intervention and he's not put for an antithyroid drugs for a long time, so the patient can have thyroid crisis during surgical intervention, and it's one of the most dreadful and deadly complication. And the patient can have severe symptoms in the form of tachypnea, tachycardia, palpitation, high-grade fever, and altered conscious level, and other types of complications. So that has to be treated. The patient has to be treated on antipyretic drugs, steroids, IV fluids, oxygen therapy, and IV antithyroid drugs, right? So I think we should end the activity right now because it's prayer time. And thank you all for participation in this activity.
People would be saturated by now, and it was a very good session.
Okay, it was a bit lengthy, but with the passage of time, we learn how to make it quick and how to make it more absorbable. And I thank you all. There are so many participants from around the province, especially Professor Anwar ul Haq from Sawat, Dr. Nader Saifullah from Ahmedabad, another. I can't think of many of you. Sorry if I can't see you properly over here on the screen. Hope we should be meeting once again.